So I sat down with him and I said, I'm kind of honestly on the fence about do I want to go into physical education or like this public health thing sounds really interesting. And he, like, as the grandfather of current PE, he said to me, he goes, if you're being called into public health, bring PE into public health. And you can always come home to PE, but if your home is actually in public health and you can bring PE into that realm, by all means, go do that. So it was a really, really formative conversation. So I decided I was not going to pursue a teaching credential in California. Instead, I was going to do an MPH.
Welcome to Public Health Careers. I'm your host, Omari Richards, founder of the Public Health Millennial. We're going to dive deep into public health topics and career journeys. You'll hear diverse career stories, absorb professional development and career strategies, get tips while also learning from others to help you in your own journey and learning of public health. Learn about the vast world of public health, public health careers, or just hear public health stories. Stay tuned so we can do our part towards a culture of health, well-being, and equity for all. Today, we have an artist, educator, and advocate for a world free of financial and socioeconomic barriers to healthy lifestyles, as well as an epidemiology supervisor. She got her Bachelor's of Science in Exercise and Nutritional Sciences and Physical Education at San Diego State University. She then got a Master of Public Health at East Stroudsburg University. She currently works as a School Associate Epidemiology Specialist Supervisor, contracting for a state health department. We have Kathleen Lynch, MPH Ches. Welcome to the show.
Hi, thanks so much for having me.
It truly, truly is my pleasure. I'm glad that we were able to connect on Instagram, and now I'm getting to interview you and looking forward to hearing you share a lot about your story.
Yeah, I'm stoked.
Awesome. So tell us, how are you doing and how you've been coping during these times?
Oh man, I am doing well. I think that's kind of an interesting question just because like when has life been normal? Ever, but especially these last few years. I'm doing well. I've been coping primarily from spending a lot of time in nature with my very active Australian Shepherd puppy. She's one, so we spend a lot of time being active together. I've also been getting back into reading, doing a lot of art. Yeah, that's kind of high level what I've been doing.
Yeah, that's awesome. And I think it's always great to have animals, and I feel like they always pull us or make us more active, or and it's a good thing because a lot of us tend to just get caught in the rung of life. But when you have like a dog, more likely a dog than a cat, you have to walk them and stuff like that, or like go
yeah
outside.
No, and she gets about 2.5 hours of exercise every day at least, so that's what we strive for. So
wow.
Yeah, we're doing a lot of activity for the last year.
Yeah, that truly is amazing and admirable. And like to that point, how do you fit that into your daily lifestyle?
So I currently have a really flexible schedule, which is really nice, and I'm working remotely, so I'm able to do like lunchtime hikes is a big one. We usually do like a long walk before I start work. Also, she goes to doggy daycare, which we call school, and she loves it. So she gets a ton of activity there on days where I'm not able to fit some of that other stuff in as much. So, but yeah, primarily walks in the morning and then like a lunchtime hike.
Okay, that makes sense. Just like seems like an active lifestyle is built around
your
just how you live and work, which is I think great and something that I think more of us should be aiming to strive for. So awesome. Keep that up.
Yeah, she's like the best personal trainer out there.
That's for sure. So tell us, how do you identify, and tell us a little bit about your personal background?
Yeah, for sure. So I'm Kathleen. Recently back to Kathleen Lynch, which is very interesting to get used to saying because I just changed it back 4 days ago. So I'm kind of working through that. So I use she, her pronouns. I, as you will find out through this conversation, am a gigantic Brené Brown fan. So also as somebody who's really into physical activity and health promotion, to anybody listening to or watching this, you might want to do some sort of physical activity game of like air squats or something anytime I mention Brené, because I guarantee you will get a really good workout in. So I actually have a quote that I wanted to read, if that's okay. Because I think it kind of ties in with how my life trajectory has going, as well as my career. Because it's kind of, there's a distinct cut point that we'll get to. But I think it really encompasses all of that really well. So it's from her book, Braving the Wilderness. The chews on the spine are courtesy of aforementioned puppy. So the quote says, only the paradox comes anywhere near to comprehending the fullness of life. We are complex beings who wake up every day and fight against being labeled and diminished with stereotypes and characterizations that don't reflect our fullness. Yet when we don't risk standing on our own and speaking out, when the options laid before us force us into the very categories we resist, we perpetuate our own disconnection and loneliness. When we're willing to risk venturing into the wilderness and even becoming our own wilderness, we feel the deepest connection to our true self and to what matters most. So that quote really, really resonates with me to the point of having a wilderness lady tattooed on my body. So yeah, that's part of my identity, is like this whole wilderness concept. Kind of going into a little bit of my personal background, I grew up in California. I was raised in the heart of Silicon Valley. I was born in the early 90s, and watched it change multiple times throughout my lifetime. So, you know, the tech companies were always there, to a certain extent in my life, in my lifetime. When I was about in fourth grade, like right around late 90s, early 2000s, there was the big tech boom. And a lot of people started moving in from outside of the area. And there was a very definite culture shift within my elementary school, within the larger school district, and within the Bay Area as a whole. So I think that's part of where my relationship with wealth and privilege really started to develop. I come from a working class family. I am one of five children, and my mom stayed home and raised all of us. She is a literal saint. And my dad's a pilot, so he was gone a lot. He was traveling the world, providing for us financially. But we definitely had a very different family dynamic, and in all reality, we had a very different financial situation than a lot of different people that I grew up around. So that kind of always had this outsider and not truly belonging, kind of undertone to when we were growing up. I then graduated from high school, went to college in San Diego. I loved San Diego. I don't think I could be a fully functioning adult living in San Diego. Like, I wouldn't want to go to work. So I graduated from there. And then my dad's actually from Pennsylvania, so that's kind of my tie here. I knew I wanted to go to grad school out of state, so I was looking at a few schools, and that's how I ended up in Pennsylvania. I moved here in 2013, so it'll be 10 years in March, which is insane. And I have been here ever since. I kind of like to refer to that point in my life, so from like 2013 until like 2020, really was a very, very challenging and very traumatic part of my life. So we'll get into that a little bit more. But that's kind of like this dark time of really developing into this person that I am now. And then in 2020 to now, I like to call it my super bloom phase. So I'm really into wildflowers. And it's interesting because one of the points of like that was a big catalyst of change was when I went to San Diego in 2019 to see the super bloom. And I just think it's really interesting that that kind of was a catalyst for a super bloom in my own life. So that's a really long-winded response to how I identify.
Oh, no, Barbara, I appreciate the context, and I'm looking forward to diving into a lot of those different topics there. And like you, my dad was also a pilot. My mom was also a stay-at-home mom, so I can probably relate.
You totally get it.
Yeah, I relate to a lot of the experiences that you're talking about. And then going back to the quotes, like some of the things that I picked up on the quote from Brené Brown that you shared were like, I feel like too many times in life, people try to put us in a box, but to that point, like we're complex beings with so many different things. And like when the more they put us in the box, and it just shuts us down from being who we can be. And like to that point, I think it's also interesting in the point of like risk and discomfort, because I think that is a part of life. Like even the wilderness, that doesn't have to necessarily be a wild wilderness, but I think the wilderness within ourselves and really pushing into that discomfort to grow. And I think about that because this last week that just passed was a very long week and a tough week, but I should say, you know, I feel like this is what life is, and like becoming that new person takes discomfort and something that doesn't feel normal. And one thing that I've learned and one thing that I'm pushing into a lot more now is pushing into that discomfort, because it has allowed me to grow and get a lot more opportunities. I'm glad that you were able to share all of that.
And
before we get more into like your public understanding, your public health stuff and like getting into your collegiate journey, I know that you were interested in aviation. So talk to us more about your interest in aviation.
Yeah. So as I mentioned, my dad's a pilot. So he has flown corporate my entire life. So we never got any of the benefits of him flying commercial. Like we never got the buddy passes or anything like that. but, you know, I had so much exposure to aviation my entire life. My grandfather on my mom's side was also a Navy pilot. So there's kind of just this large undertone of aviation. Well, it's also not an undertone in my case. My dad is in it, and we've always been around it. But we used to spend hours just at the hangar watching planes take off and land. And it's still one of my favorite activities to do. So I have kind of danced around wanting to go into aviation my entire life. I remember when I was late in high school, starting to look at college, I was seriously considering doing Air Force ROTC. And then I discovered that you have to be 5'4", and I'm only 5'2.5".
Wow. That's
so wild. So that disqualified me from that. But I think there's actually also a lot of public health within aviation. There's a large kind of reckoning going on right now related to mental health in aviation. So I started taking lessons. I took it's called a discovery ride, where it's like an hour flight and you're actually in the left seat. So it was the coolest. Well, prior to 2 weeks ago, it was the coolest flight I've ever taken. There's one that has now surpassed that. But so it was really cool. I was super excited. And then I learned after the fact that in order to get an FAA medical clearance, you essentially can't have any mental health diagnoses. You can't necessarily, it's a little gray. There's a lot of discretion left to flight surgeons and aviation medical examiners to determine whether or not you can get your clearance. And mental health is really, really a hot topic with that right now, to the point where the FAA is working on it. The AOPA is working on it. So I'm kind of feeling more and more drawn to, okay, I have this interest. I personally have been impacted by it. I have the skill set as an epidemiologist. I have been kicking around the idea of a doctorate program. So I feel like the universe is kind of pointing me in this direction. So stay tuned. We'll see what happens there. But yeah, I feel like I actually could bring some skills that are very much needed into this conversation and help address the pilot shortage in that way.
Yeah, that's fascinating. And I love it in the sense that But when we talk about populations in public health, there's just so many different populations that you can focus on. And I think, like, to that point, coming across this niche interest of, okay, I have this epidemiology skill set, but I also love aviation, and I see the intersection of the mental health issues that are happening in aviation. How can I use these skill sets? And just for everyone who's listening, the AOPA is the Aircraft Owner and Pilot Association, and the FAA is the Federal Aviation Administration. Just because I would not have known those acronyms. No need to be sorry.
Myself I wouldn't get jargony, but I did.
That's how it tends to go sometimes. And then you also have interest in being an artist or creating art. Do you want to share more about that?
Artist is actually a title, shall we say, that I've started using very recently. So it was something I really struggled with. I felt like this shame of, like, who am I to call myself an artist? I didn't go to art school. I just, like, make art, kind of a thing. I had a piece that I submitted to a local art show over the summer. It's called Against the Odds, and it was featured in an exhibit for local LGBTQA+ artists in our area. The name of the exhibit was Queering Care, and my piece really kind of brought two parts of my brain together. So the background of it is a collage of health disparities data looking specifically at LGBTQ youth, as well as the larger population. I live in Pennsylvania, and we actually have a LGBTQ health needs assessment that's conducted statewide every 3 years. So it's amazing, and it is a huge resource for health systems and for organizations that are working on addressing health disparities within our community. So I actually pulled some of the data from that most recent report, I guess we'll call it. So that's the background. And it kind of, if you just have that background, it's in black and white. It's very not promising. And then what I did over it was I painted, like, brightly colored flowers and groupings of plants to kind of show how we as a community come together to kind of care for ourselves. There's a long-standing history within the LGBTQ population of community care, and that was the overall theme. And prior to that exhibition, I never would have called myself an artist until we were asked on the panel, like, how do you identify as an artist? And I had to verbally vocalize that I was an artist, and it was so strange to me. I was like, I'm not, but I am. So I am reclaiming that now. My mom is very much an artist as well. So we grew up just, art was part of our nature. All of our activities were either art or nature based, or usually nature art based. So it's something that I've always kind of gone back to. And it's something that, especially during the pandemic, I really started leaning into to kind of help me through it, to process what was going on, to pass the time. And I actually, this is one of my most exciting art stories. When I was furloughed at the start of COVID, there's a brewery down the street that I love and have become very good friends with the owner. And it's just a hub of community within our area of town, and the larger community as well. And I was really bored the one day, and I had just taken this online, like, workshop on, like, building illustrations, essentially. So I was like, oh, this would be really fun. I'm just going to illustrate Bond Place. So I illustrated it, and I took it down to Sam, the owner, and was basically like, you know, I did this for fun. You can do anything you want with it. You can throw it in the trash. You can make it into, like, whatever you want, kind of thing. So that was in April 2020. Then fast forward to November 2020, I got a text from Sam saying, hey, are you okay if we use your art on a beer label? So I was so excited. So I also, it was basically a collaboration brew with another brewery that I love. And they wanted both buildings on the label. And he was like, the style that you did perfectly encompasses us and what we stand for. So my art is on a beer label, and that is my claim to fame as an artist.
That's awesome. I don't think many people can say that.
Yeah, it was so cool. I almost cried when he texted me.
That's amazing. That's amazing. And just so people are aware, we'll either have that image up on the screen, or we'll definitely have a link in the description, so you can click on it to see the art that Kathleen is talking about, as well as if she can send us a picture of the beer label, we'll have that as well.
Oh, so
you
can
check that out. But I think it's awesome. And one thing that I think you highlight is just doing something makes you something. So as in the point of like, you're doing art, you're an artist, you mm-hmm. go for hikes, you're a hiker. And like, once you're actively engaging in something, you are something. And I think too many times we tell ourselves, oh, we're not this because we don't have that official label. We didn't go to school right. for this or that. But there are so many intersectionalities and so many roles that we take up in life. And it switches a lot depending on where we are and who we are around. So just wanted to say that for anyone else that might be doing something, you are whatever you do. So just do what you are and like say it and be proud of that. Yeah, appreciate that. But the other thing that I thought was cool is the Pennsylvania LGBTQ plus state assessments. I know that Florida got rid of its youth risk behavioral mm-hmm. survey, I think last year, which is crazy. But now there are other states that are doing amazing work to ensure that there are more inclusive data out there and really helpful to other stakeholders that just were not informed of what are the needs and the necessities of these different communities. So I think that's really awesome. And I hope that other states are able to do very similar work. Okay, so what does public health mean to you before we get into your collegiate story?
Yeah, so I actually think it's really interesting that conversation segued into that question, because there's so much gatekeeping, I feel like, within public health. And I view it the polar opposite way. I think, you know, Brené Brown, she talks about how sometimes it's easier to define something by what it's not rather than what it is. And to me, public health is not individuality and individual focused, whether it's health or economics or anything like that. Like, public health is completely systemic and it's all connected. You can kind of go outside and see public health everywhere. So yeah, I mean, that's not really like a hugely academic answer or anything like that, but I think it's kind of everything around us can be public health.
Yeah, I absolutely believe that. And I just like that thought process, because as I said on my Instagram very recently, people think of public health and they think of the CDC or the FDA or all these other like federal organizations, but there's mm-hmm. so much more to public health. And by not encompassing public health in all those different roles and positions that people are doing, there's just so much missed and so much lost, and a loss of collaboration and understanding of like bigger picture of, okay, let's focus mm-hmm. on populations and improve the health, but have this lens of public health and all the work. And yeah, I see public health in so many avenues that people just don't think of it or say, oh, I'm doing this, I'm not really doing public health work. But you are.
Right. You are.
Yeah. So
sorry. And we need that. More people doing it. Like, we need more people claiming that title of a public health professional, whether you have a public health background or not. Like, if you're doing work that is improving the health of populations of people, you are a public health worker.
Absolutely. 100% agree with that. Okay, so you got your bachelor's degree in exercise and nutritional sciences and physical education at San Diego State University. What was the thought process going into this degree?
Yeah, so I played sports growing up. I was highly active. And I also come from a large family on both sides of nurses and teachers. So I kind of knew I wanted to go into one of those fields. So I actually went in undeclared my freshman year. Then I was getting more and more interested in like biology and kinesiology. So that at San Diego State, the kinesiology degree is exercise and nutritional sciences. So I went in exercise nutritional sciences, and my emphasis to start was fitness, nutrition, and health, which a lot of people kind of went into like the personal training route out of that, that probably was, or like into like a nutrition program, which I didn't see that as like a long-term thing I wanted to do. And then my brother had actually graduated a few years before with the same degree from San Diego State, and his emphasis was physical education. And I had talked to him about it, got really interested. So I went into the PE area of focus, which was a really interesting time to do it because at that time, San Diego State had just created a doctorate in physical therapy program. And the way funding was working, they basically had to eliminate one of the undergrad emphasis areas to be able to support the DPT program. And the PE program was really, really small. So we were the one that got cut. And so we were literally like the dinosaurs of San Diego State PE. So that was kind of how I got into it. And how it ended.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. And I think it's always great to have like the exposure. As you said, I think your brother was in mm-hmm. the program. There was a health focus that you knew you wanted to do, went in undeclared, went in to do more kinesiology type of stuff, and then came out of there with a huge new understanding of like what health is. Mm-hmm. And I'm guessing more about what you wanted to pursue afterwards. So were there any mm-hmm. takeaways from undergrad that you had?
Yeah, I mean, kind of go into it with an open mind. There are some people who know exactly what they want to do from the second seemingly they're born. Then there are some of us that know what we want to do a little bit later in life, and that's fine. So I'm really glad that I kind of took the path that I did and let my interests and experience kind of dictate that. One of the big takeaways from the program for me, because we were literally watching our program get cut as we were graduating. So one of the things that really showed to us was, especially in California at that time, PE jobs were very few and far between and really hard to come by. So in order to preserve your job at the end of every single year, they really instilled an appreciation for evidence and data collection and data analysis into your classes. So we were kind of taught how to do program evaluation without calling it program evaluation in our undergrad training, so that they literally said, you know, you are going to be in a position where you have to defend your job at the end of every year. So you better have data to show why they should keep your job, because the school board isn't going to understand, you know, the thoughts and feelings as much as they are going to say, here's heart rate data from my students' classes, and here's how my class is improving their overall well-being. So that was something that really stuck with me and came pretty naturally to me.
That makes sense. And I feel like to gain that program evaluation skill, or just to like be thinking about it in undergrad, is a great asset. And yeah, I could imagine how important that is, not only just understanding how to do it, but saying, okay, we need to do this to advocate for this position that I'm doing, mm-hmm. and to show that like it is something that we need, because a lot of times we might have the thought process or like inclining that it is that we need it, but like, to your point, having that data and being able to back it up outside of just the qualitative mm-hmm. is also important. So shout out to you for that. And then you got your Master's of Public Health at East Shrewsbury, I think I said it wrong, University of Pennsylvania. Okay. When did you hear about public health or like what was that process of thinking about master's programs and then choosing a Master of Public Health?
Yeah, so It was my last semester of my undergrad. I don't even remember what class it was at this point, but we watched a documentary. It was an HBO documentary, and it was called The Weight of the Nation. And I remember it basically was looking at obesity through like three different lenses. In retrospect, it was a very much a public health lens to be looking at it. It was very systems focused. And I remember distinctly in the watching this documentary that every time I was like, yeah, like I really agree with what they're saying. Oh, that's really interesting. Every single person had an MPH. So I was like, okay, I hear you. What's an MPH? So then I went and I researched that a little bit more. And I actually had the opportunity as an undergrad to go to the National Convention for Public Education Teacher Education. So I went to that convention. I graduated in December, and this convention was in November, early November, probably. And I had the opportunity at that convention to talk to some professors from other universities and kind of just understand a little bit more. And I was able to talk to somebody who's kind of like the grandfather of current PE. He was professor at San Diego State. I think he had just retired, like not long before I got there, but he was still very involved with our program. So I talked to him and I said, you know, I'm kind of at this crossroads. In California, when you graduate with an education degree, you don't do your student teaching within your bachelor's. So you actually have to go back for another year. You do some coursework, you do your student teaching, and then you go into actually teaching. So I knew I was going to have to do at least one more year of school before I could actually have my own classes. So I sat down with him and I said, you know, I'm kind of honestly on the fence about do I want to go into physical education or like this public health thing sounds really interesting. And he, like, as the grandfather of current PE, he said to me, he goes, if you're being called into public health, bring PE into public health. And you can always come home to PE, but if your home is actually in public health and you can bring PE into that realm, by all means, go do that. So it was a really, really formative conversation. So I decided I was not going to pursue a teaching credential in California. Instead, I was going to do an MPH. And that's how I ended up selecting East Stroudsburg. I didn't want to do it at a school either where I did my undergrad or really close to my parents. So that kind of got rid of California. So I was looking between Colorado and Pennsylvania, and I really liked Pennsylvania growing up. We used to visit here all the time. So I really liked it. And I was like, you know what? It's 2 years. Let's see what happens. So I came, and I've been here ever since.
Okay, well, I appreciate that and you sharing that. And I think it just makes so much sense going from doing sports in high school to going in to get this like kinesiology type degree to learning more about broader public health to then seeing these people in the documentary have MPHs to go in and learn to see, okay, what an MPH is. And then from there, having the conversation, okay, there are two paths that I'm leaning on. PE and having to complete to get teacher credit in the state or just go in and get my master's of public health. And I love that you use people around you and experts around you that you had access to get their perspectives and really say, hey, if public health is calling, jump into that and bring PE along, which I think is the keys for anything that you want to do really is like. And that's one thing that I love about master's of public health programs in specifically is that it's broad enough for you to bring your own interest and then deepen your knowledge in whatever interest is. So to that point, like if you want to do PE and like focus more on PE during your master's of public health, definitely do it. So that was your thought process. That's what you learned about public health. Was there a concentration that you chose and why?
So East Stroudsburg has one option for a concentration. So it's community health education, which is honestly what I would have chosen anyway. I I kind of had the perspective of like, you know, I don't necessarily want, this is very funny to say this in retrospect, but I was like, I don't want like an infectious disease epi job. I don't necessarily want to work for like a state health department or the CDC or anything like that. So I was like, a community health education background is like exactly what I want. I'm really into building community and harnessing the power of community to improve health of populations. So I kind of went into it with that perspective, and now find myself working in infectious disease epi contracting for a state. But you know, that's how life happens.
Absolutely, absolutely. And during your time during your MPH, you were a graduate research assistant at East Strasbourg University. So tell me about that experience.
Yeah, so it was mostly for my publishable paper. I was working with one of the faculty members as well. I brought my, you know, physical activity viewpoint into my MPH, and kind of everything I was working on within my MPH was very much focusing on physical activity promotion. So her research really aligned with that. And there's a large community 5K that has probably been going on for over 30 years at this point. And it's the Women's 5K Classic in the Lehigh Valley. So one of the huge benefits of it is it draws so many people who wouldn't necessarily be physically active otherwise because of the cause. So her research was basically looking at how do we harness this community drive to fundraise and exercise on behalf of breast and cervical cancer, and how do we kind of translate that into long-term physical activity. So that's kind of what her research was on. And then for my paper for graduation, I focused specifically looking at how intrinsic versus extrinsic motivation, as well as type of training, impacted post-race physical activity levels.
And what did you find when you did that type of research?
So there were a lot of limitations to my study specifically. The race takes place in early October, and then we were doing follow-up surveys. I don't even remember, but one of the follow-up surveys hit on either Black Friday or Cyber Monday. So, you know, everyone's getting like hundreds of advertising emails. Yeah. And we're like, hey, fill out our survey. So like, not surprisingly, we didn't get a great response rate for especially that one. So with our limited data, one of the things that we did see was there was definitely a significant decrease in activity, like 4, 6, 8 weeks following the event. But there were no significant differences based off of motivation, which was really interesting to me because I very much went into it thinking people who were intrinsically motivated were going to have higher levels of activity after the race, and they didn't. But, and again, that's also based off of time of year, and it's Pennsylvania and it's starting to get really cold. So there are a lot of factors there.
Yeah, absolutely. Thanks for sharing that. And I think that's a lesson for anyone out there. Do not send out emails or try to collect information to people on Black Friday or anytime around that, especially via
absolutely
email.
Absolutely not. No. Yeah, that was my number one takeaway from that research study.
That's important information. And you are also a patient access representative at a regional health network. So tell us a little bit about that experience.
Yeah, so actually when I moved here, my first job was working in the childcare at the local YMCA. And kind of by happenstance, there's a hospital down the street from where I live. They're part of a larger regional network. And the bus driver for our kiddos that we would take to and from school, he and I spent a lot of time together because I would be on the bus when they got dropped off at school. We would wait for them together when we were picking them up, all that. So we got to talking, and his wife was the manager for patient access at the hospital. So basically it's like the registration staff. So he was able to get me in connection with her. And I worked that job all through grad school. So it was really interesting because they're the people who at a hospital level are collecting demographics data, are, you know, that first line of ensuring that there is a data quality within any information that you're pulling from hospitals or health systems. So being a public health student and seeing how like health data is used, I took it really seriously to make sure that every field was filled out correctly. So that, you know, when we're looking at health disparities data, you need to make sure that the patient's race and ethnicity are collected correctly if you're going to be able to say in this region, here's what health disparities look like based off of race and ethnicity. So it was a really, really good experience. It was also really fun. I got to talk to so many different people. There's one point where I got to work registering lab specimens. So it was like the surgical ones were my favorites. There was one time that like I literally got to register an eyelid, which like most people would think it's really gross, but I was fascinated by it. So I really got to learn, you know, how hospital systems and hospital data works within that position. So it was a great grad school position.
Yeah, that's important. And I think like to that point of like equity and being able to collect the data to say, okay, this is what this population is experiences. So we could actually like not only have that data, but have like a baseline to work towards to improve and then work from there, which is like a huge part of the equity conversation. And I feel like health systems have taken so long to pick up on this, but I'm grateful that you're doing that work and the health system that you work for was collecting that data. And shout out to you for like being very stringent on trying to collect the data to inform that work going forward. And I believe at the same organization you became a community health program evaluation intern. So tell us about that.
So basically that was my in, and then I was with that organization. So I started there in 2014. I was with it until 2020. So like the next 6 years of my career were within that organization. So while I was a grad student and working in registration, I reached out to our chair of community health and kind of had an informational interview with her and learned more about the department, and then said, yeah, I'm really interested in doing an internship with this department. And at the time I was really thinking, I was really interested in like epi and program evaluation. So I was able to do an internship. It was a few months with the organization or with that specific department. And it was really interesting. It was during, it would have been like spring 2015. So they were kind of gearing up for the data collection phase for the 2016 community health needs assessment. So it was a really cool time to be working with them. I was doing a lot of helping with like the secondary data analysis, starting to get boots on the ground stuff ready to go with the survey and primary data analysis, as well as kind of starting to get my feet wet with, we had an employee wellness program that had just launched. So I did the program evaluation for that, got to help set that up. Which has been something that I carried through in my job within that department. So at the end of my internship, they basically said, yeah, we would be interested in bringing you on as an epidemiologist. The person who was in the position prior to me was promoted to an epi manager, and then I kind of backfilled that role.
Okay. And before we get into that transition, there, you said it, you're doing a program evaluation, and I know earlier you shared that you learned about program evaluation at least a little bit in your bachelor's program, you're in your MPH program. So where are you getting the most of your program evaluation knowledge? Is it just from your bachelor's program? Is that something you covered again in your MPH program, or is it just something you're learning on the job?
So we had a class, we had a whole program evaluation class. It was actually probably one of the best classes I had in my MPH. I really enjoyed it. It was taught by an adjunct instructor who was working in the field at the time, so she had so much amazing knowledge that she brought to it. So Yeah, I pulled a lot from that class, and then, you know, just MPH in general.
Okay. And earlier on, when you said you started your MPH program, you said you had no interest in infectious disease, no interest in epidemiology. And here you are, first job out of your MPH as an epidemiologist at a regional health network. So tell me, what was that transition like for you during your program, or just like in your mindset in doing this work?
Yeah, so I mean, my title was epidemiologist. I still really struggle with that having been my title. I think like program evaluation specialist or something along those lines would have been a much better title, because we weren't really doing much epidemiology. short of, we were doing a lot of like social epi analysis type of work, especially within the community health needs assessment. But yeah, that's one of those things that I still kind of am coming to terms with of, was I really an epidemiologist? I don't know. There are different facets to epi. So yeah.
Fair enough. Okay. So they might have had should have had a better title for you. Regardless, what type of work did you do in this position?
So we had a bunch of different community-based programs that we ran. So I did the program evaluation. So I would work with the program managers to kind of look at what the goals of the program were, and then would have monthly meetings with them to see what benchmarks they were either meeting or missing, and making adjustments to the program as a result. So I was doing a lot of very close work with the program managers and overseeing the data collection with the program staff. One of the skills that I brought to that position was, you know, emotional intelligence and people skills. So when programs weren't performing the way that they needed to be, I was able to kind of, it was their friend Kathleen coming and talking to them instead of, you know, the big bad epidemiologist being like, you're not meeting your targets. It was like, hey, like, what's going on? Like, what's preventing this program from meeting these targets? What's preventing you from collecting the data real time? Like, what does this actually look like for you? And then being able to work with the program managers to hopefully make some of those changes. So yeah, it was a lot of program evaluation. We also had a local nonprofit that we worked with, and I helped them with the same thing. So they were doing a lot of work with the Hispanic population within our area. So working with them on their data collection. And, you know, these are people that most of them have a high school diploma or an associate's degree. So really relying on them to be the context experts within the area, and building a relationship where I could be this like data content expert, but help them kind of navigate that so that it was still true to them and true to their organization. And it wasn't, you know, me coming in and telling them how to do their jobs. Again, it was me sitting with them, watching how their job operates and seeing like, this is not a sterile like research environment. Like, you have to be able to make some of those adjustments away from these very, very hard program evaluation rules that we would have otherwise had.
Absolutely. And I love the point of you saying that you're not coming in there as a big bad wolf in both circumstances, working with community or working in the organization, and you're like just really trying to meet people where they're at and like letting them know that you're a partner and that you're trying to help support their work, and you can only do that as long as best as you can when they're coming to you, and building that network and that trust and having those conversations. So that's also very, very important. And after this, or during this time, you became an adjunct instructor for two universities. So at East Shrewsbury University of Pennsylvania, I'm sorry if I got that wrong once again.
It's okay.
And adjunct instructor at Muhlenberg College. So what was the thought process for you, like just wanting to become an adjunct instructor, and how how did you get into becoming an adjunct instructor and then for two schools?
Yeah, so I, you know, teaching has always been part of what I've wanted to do. So I knew I wanted, part of the reason I wanted to get my master's to begin with was so that I could teach at a community college level. And during, you know, that time when I was working in community health, my graduate advisor had been working on some classes through the degree completion program at East Stroudsburg. And so there was an opportunity to kind of shift me into teaching two of those classes. So I taught, it was like a very basic level intro to EPI and environmental health. And they were actually taught concurrently. I was going down to Philadelphia to start. And then the next time I did it, it was the local program. So it was a really cool experience. I got to meet some awesome students who had like the coolest career backstories. Like I had a student who had worked in a prison and was able to bring that to class and would challenge me and would, you know, ask questions that students who are coming right out of high school don't necessarily have. So I loved teaching in that program. I mean, it definitely had challenges, but this, like, student wise, they were so eager to learn. They brought such rich life experience that it was really fulfilling for me. And then unfortunately the program, like, I think got eliminated. I don't remember. There was a lot also going on personally at that time. So I wasn't able to keep doing it anymore at that point anyway. But yeah, so I loved it though. It was great. Yeah, and then, yeah. So that was the East Stroudsburg one. And then Muhlenberg, that one, my boss at the time had been asked to teach it. And she wasn't able to do it. So she asked me to do it as a bonus for my hard work, which being like, you know, in your mid to late 20s and having this opportunity to teach at a college was really exciting. I didn't necessarily think through like, is this actually a bonus with more work? But you know, yeah. So with that one, I taught an intro to global health class. And that one, they needed somebody to kind of backfill a position really quickly. So it was a really good experience. I really liked it, but they only needed me for that one semester.
Yeah. And outside of like the importance of understanding that people are coming to class, or some people are coming to class with life experiences that are just mm-hmm. just as important. And I think like you focusing on you also leading as the instructor, as someone that is gaining experience from people's other experiences that they can come back and share with the class. Are there any other things around being an adjunct instructor that you like to share, or like any things that you learned or advice that you'd give?
I don't really know.
That's yeah. absolutely fine.
Yeah.
No problem. I feel like
I don't have anything profound to say for that.
Yeah, that's absolutely fine. And I think like just in the profoundness of you sharing that, you know, that this person came to class with these experiences and they challenged my experiences and my knowledge, I think that's important to share, because too many times we think that we're the experts, especially like instructors, professors, think that they know everything, but people have lived experiences and that lived experiences makes them experts. And they might have even work experiences that give them experts on different things. So really just having that open mind and having a space for all those conversations to happen, I think is a huge part of the learning process.
Yeah, and I think it's having the humility to admit, I don't know. Like, there were so many times when students would ask me questions, and I said, you know, I don't know today. Let me research that. Let me kind of gather some information and we can revisit it next time we have class. And I think that's really important, to show the skill of not knowing something, which is a life skill, honestly. So yeah, I guess there's my little profound nugget for being an adjunct instructor. You don't know everything and you don't have to.
Absolutely. I feel like you should always try to not be the smartest person in the room, because that way you're always learning and growing. So not knowing is a great thing, because then that means that there's so much more to learn out there. So yeah. And then you got a promotion at the Regional Health Network that you're at to Manager of Oncology for Patient Support Services. Mm-hmm. So how did this promotion come about? And then what did you do in this position?
Yeah, so this is like kind of that transition out of like the dark ages into the super bloom phase. So one thing I neglected to mention with the community health position is within that job, I also, in addition to doing a ton of legwork for our network community health needs assessments, our cancer center was accredited by the Commission on Cancer through the American College of Surgeons. And at that point in time, in order to have the accreditation and to maintain the accreditation, they had, like, the cancer center themselves had to do a triennial needs assessment. So the way that the hospital system managed that was they basically had somebody within community health who did their needs assessment for them. So that was part of the justification for me getting that epidemiology job, was they needed somebody to kind of serve as this cancer liaison. So in addition to all the program evaluation parts I was doing, I was also wearing this oncology liaison hat and doing the needs assessment for that, and kind of not doing the programs by any means, but kind of working with the program managers and the program leaders to track improvements on the implementation plan. So I personally and professionally got to a very dark place in 2018, 2019, and I needed out. So there was a point in the summer of 2018 when I had been applying externally to like pharmaceutical companies and kind of everything that I thought I might be able to get a job in. And unfortunately, I had had so many experiences within my job world that made me feel like I wasn't qualified for anything other than what I was currently doing. So I didn't have true epi experience. I didn't have direct program experience. So I really just felt trapped and pigeonholed. And I was kind of talking about it to one of the surgical oncologists that I was very close with, and mentioned to them that I was applying externally. And they, she took that and she was like, no, we can't lose you. Like, you do so much for this program. You're the person who knows how this is all working. Like, we cannot lose you. So she took it to the program administrator and basically said, Kathleen's looking to leave. We need to bring her on full time into oncology because she can't be in her position anymore. So that was like this huge also evidence, I guess, I don't know, example, another word, a huge example of like female empowerment and like, you know, knowing your worth and knowing your friend's worth and being able to go and fight for them. So it basically started this huge, long process of kind of getting me out of community health. It was almost a year from when that started until I actually got into oncology. So yes, it was a promotion. It was also like a rescue lifeboat. And in retrospect, I agreed to a lot more than I probably should have because of the position I was in that I needed to get out of. So so that's kind of how I got into oncology full time.
Yeah, that makes sense. And I think it speaks to the point of like just sharing things with your network, because you never know what will happen from there or who is going to be that advocate that says, you know, like, hey, your work is really important here. And even like maybe because you don't see it other people are seeing the importance of the work that you're doing, and like just sharing those conversations and having those conversations, I think are important for people that might want to advocate for you, or maybe share a position with you, or like connect you with someone that might be worthwhile. So like just having those conversations are important. So are you getting to the point of saying that like taking on this new role was the thing that made life go dark and tough, or was it before this?
No, so it was before that. It was basically like 2017 until 2019 were really, really challenging, personally and professionally. And then there was a big like personal situation that happened in spring of 2019, that kind of turned my whole world upside down. And that was kind of this catalyst for massive growth. So that's one, when I got into therapy consistently. Two, it's when I started working on like my own issues with belonging and self-worth, and what do I accept from other people, which I then brought into this new job with me. So that was kind of like that shift, the start of the shift. I really found my voice at that point and was starting to advocate more for myself. I had been advocating for other people for so long, but it really allowed me to kind of start to find my voice and then lean into my voice a lot more, and kind of start to become my own wilderness a little bit.
Awesome. Well, we love that for you. First of all, I'm glad that you're able to like,
thank you,
make that privilege and like really get into super bloom, as you said, which I think is amazing. I know you shared a little bit about the job as a manager of oncology patient support services. Was there anything else that you wanted to share, like what you did?
Yeah, sure. So that was my like intro to management, and it was very much like trial by fire. So I was in that role from July 2019 until June 2020, but I was furloughed in April 2020. So I was actually like working in it for July to April, so however many months that is. But in that time, my job in that position was, in addition to all of the screening and prevention and public health work that I was already doing with oncology, I also took on the role of manager for basically everything that allowed our patients to be humans. So I had our social work team, I had our dietitians, I had our healing arts program, and then I also had our nurse educators who were educating our patients as well as the nurses. So I had a lot on my plate that I was trying to juggle. I basically had like 5 very different aspects to my job. And because it had so much to do with health equity work and screening and prevention, and then we had these development funds, I was also working very closely with our development program to ensure that the funds that were donated to us were used appropriately and like allocating those. So like professionally, there was a ton to kind of like get accustomed to in that. But then personally, there was also a lot going on. So I had, my dad is from the area. My dad is one of 7 children. And I started this job in July. And in September, my aunt, who is the youngest of the family, was diagnosed with pancreatic cancer and was receiving treatment where I worked. So with 6 other personalities in the mix, there was kind of a lot of pull going on, to the point, and some of my aunts and uncles were trying to pull me into situations that I really shouldn't have been in. And I had to have a conversation with my dad. And it was one of the first like adult to adult conversations I had with my parents up till that point, where I said, look, like, I understand it's your family, but this is my career and I cannot be pulled into these situations. So kind of, you know, talk to your siblings before I like lash out at them. So that was like a really challenging situation to navigate. My aunt ended up passing away in November. So that was going on for about 2 months. And then right after she passed away, a couple weeks later, there was actually one of my team members who passed away unexpectedly. So I had this like death in my family. Then I had a death of one of the people that reported to me. So I had to learn, you know, all of that management skill. And how do you learn that? Like you don't. It's kind of one of those moments where you say, okay, who am I? And how am I as a human going to respond in this moment? And that's kind of just what I did. So there's that. There are all sorts of like team issues. And then in January or February, there was a patient who had reported to one of our social workers that she was being sexually harassed by one of the drivers of our like free transportation programs. So that was probably one of the hardest situations that I navigated. As a woman, I was infuriated that there was a patient who had to deal with that going to and from cancer treatment. So she actually pulled me into a meeting with this patient. And the patient basically told me she knew she wasn't going to make it. But she needed to share her story with me so that I could do something about it and to make sure that no other patients were experiencing that. So that was really, really hard. My manager at the time, was a male and his boss was a woman. So I basically told him, you know, I need to make sure that this is actually taken seriously. And unfortunately, this is something that every woman has an experience with. So I need to speak to her woman to woman, just like this patient trusted me woman to woman. So it was one of those very formative experiences as well of like, again, who am I? How am I going to handle this? How do we move forward from this together? So yeah, on top of, you know, all of the other patient aspects, kind of just learning a lot about who I was and how I was going to handle adversity in very intense situations.
Wow.
Yeah.
that is a lot, going into like a management role. Condolences on the loss of your aunt or the loss of your coworker.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah. Then no one wants to see, especially people that are in situations where their health is on the line being, well, no one wants to see anyone being sexually harassed or assaulted in general. But I think like, especially that, I don't know, that's very disheartening in so many ways.
Yeah.
And I think all of that goes to show like just how resilient you were and the growth that I could only imagine that you experienced during that time. I could also imagine how hard it might have been during those times and all the doubts and all the thoughts that you might have had. But just wanted to say like shout out to you for persevering, for mm-hmm. going through that and becoming who you are today. Not because of those experiences, but those experiences are part of your journey and learning that I think a lot of people don't get to do, but to that point is very formative for you to have these experiences so you know who you are and you can show up in those types of situations even better when similar situations happen in life or in work going forward.
Yeah, thank you. I wouldn't wish it on anybody by any means.
Yeah. Well, I'm glad that you can laugh now. I'm glad. I'm happy to hear that.
I mean, hey, therapy is a great thing.
Absolutely. And then in your current role, you're a school mm-hmm. associate epidemiology specialist supervisor at a State Department of Health contracted through another organization. Mm-hmm. So How is this different? Firstly, is this different being a school associate epidemiology specialist supervisor? Is that different from being like an epidemiologist? What's the difference?
So it's basically within like the actual Department of Health jobs, there's like an epi research associate. And it's a very similar position, but because it's contract, it had to have a different title and all that. But it's a very similar position as I think, at least within the state where I am contracting, in order to be an epidemiologist, you have to have a PhD. So the epi research associate is the like master's level equivalent of, but for all intents and purposes, we're different levels of epidemiologist.
Okay, appreciate that. And then you shared that you had an epidemiologist job earlier that was not really an epidemiologist job. Now you're in a more epidemiology type job. How did you go about like learning the skill sets to advocate for yourself to get this type of position?
Yeah. So I was very, very much invested in my oncology work. And then COVID hit. So because I was overseeing the team that essentially didn't generate any revenue within oncology as like pay cuts, or not pay cuts, but as staffing cuts and things like that were happening early on in the pandemic, unfortunately, my position was one of the ones that was furloughed. So I was furloughed. It was supposed to be for 90 days, April through June 2020. So I really took that time to heal. 2017 to 2019 were very, very traumatic and very hard, as we just talked about. So I really took a lot of time then to heal and kind of regroup and find out like, okay, what do I want to do? And I was really planning on going back to that position, kind of rejuvenated. I had a whole like, I was furloughed for 90 days. So I came up with like an idea a day. I had a note in my phone and everything like that. And then they eliminated my position. So when that happened, I cried because I said, you know what, like, looking at this holistically, I have an MPH in the middle of a pandemic. I can get a job, but people are going to die because this position doesn't exist. So that was kind of how that all ended. So again, because I had an MPH during a pandemic, I was very fortunate to be able to get this contracting position as an epi associate, basically. And we have like regional associates. So the state is broken up into different districts. So they were hiring contractors for the districts, but then they were also hiring for like site specific teams. And because of my background in physical education and because of having more of like a social epi lens, they actually had me take over the K-12 school response. So I was essentially the lead epidemiology like associate for the K-12 school response. It was me by myself for most of the 2020 into 21 school year. And then there was a floater who was able to come over onto my team to help. And then starting in the 2021-22 school year, we were actually able to budget to have an actual team. So that's when I got promoted to supervisor.
What sorts of things do you do as a school associate epidemiologist specialist supervisor?
So we basically are the team that schools reach out to when they have any kind of situation that they need epi help with. So it's really shifted every single year. The first school year, there were, you know, mandated school closures if case counts got to a certain level. But it was a matrix and there was a lot of gray area. So it was really helping school administrators mostly try to navigate that gray. So again, that's where I was really pulling from my skill set of emotional intelligence and just people skills, and also having a background in education and understanding how like instructional day requirements work and things that somebody with just an epi background wouldn't necessarily have that that knowledge base. Yeah, it was a lot of like health education on the fly. In addition to, I recognized very early on that the actual infectious disease epi part of my job was not my skill set, but I knew who the experts were and I knew to reach out to them, and I could actually use my skill set to be that liaison and translate between these very, very intelligent epidemiologists and infectious disease epis who just fascinate me with what they're able to do. But I could translate that into school speak and talk to administrators and talk them off ledges when, like, they think they're going to have to close for 14 days, and really be able to find out more about the situation and say, okay, what's actually happening, like walking through the scenario with them and finding something that we kind of had to take more of a harm reduction approach. So kind of finding a middle ground of like, what with your school community, what's really important, and how do we kind of navigate that? Which, again, having that resilience and that skill set of knowing who I am, knowing what I stand for, knowing that people are going to disagree with every single decision that I make, it's been really challenging. Like, I would be lying if I said, you know, it's been a cakewalk working in schools and COVID. Because, again, coming from a family of teachers, like, even going to family gatherings, hearing everybody's perspective on what their school's doing, like just having to leave the room multiple times, yeah. Because, you know, this is a nice gathering. I'm not going to offer my perspective on COVID. So, yeah, so that's kind of what we have been doing. At this point in the response, schools aren't reaching out necessarily as much. So it's definitely shifted, but that's, you know, high level what we're there for.
I like the point of, I feel like this one of the big skill sets that people get from public health is being able to take complex things and communicate it to whatever mm-hmm. population that might be, and just how important that is. So I appreciate you highlighting that.
Yeah, I mean, it's definitely something that I've had to lean heavily on. That and knowing your skills, knowing your limitations, and reaching out to experts and not pretending like you know. So that has been something that has really helped me as well.
Awesome. And then you are also part of, or you would like to speak to, the American Heart Association Leaders of Impact. So tell me a little bit more about that.
Oh, yeah. So one of my good friends is the local executive director of the American Heart Association. And I was nominated by her to participate in, it's a large fundraising campaign. It's called Leaders of Impact. And I decided to also put my health educator hat on. So I'm actually doing like a whole health education campaign with it too, where we're focusing on the six pillars of health in lifestyle medicine and getting a lot of information out about that. So it's been really challenging. It's been a long time since I've been doing like daily content or daily health education, but it's been like really rejuvenating to get to do it. So
okay, awesome. Yeah. Thank you for sharing that. And you also have your CHES, or Certified Health Education Specialist, and I know you wanted to share more about the exam and certification and discuss it briefly, so we'd love to hear more about your experiences with this.
Yeah, so one of the career goals that I had for myself was I knew I wanted to get my CHES certification. I was actually talked out of it by a previous supervisor who said I would never need it. So I, you know, once again, like listened to myself and was like, no, you know what? I do want to get this. So when I was furloughed in April, I made the goal to take the exam in the October date and kind of make that my 30th birthday present to myself. So yeah, Geek Squad, 30th birthday present. Like, I want to take this rigorous exam and get my certification. But it was really good, and it really reinforced what I want to be doing. And especially going into this COVID role, it was really nice to kind of have that all refreshed. So if anybody is considering getting their CHES certification, it's great. I'm so happy I have it. They're a great organization also.
Awesome. Well, yeah, absolutely. And it is, as I always say, the one certification that I've heard people in public health get the most benefit from, just generally speaking. So yeah, definitely check it out if that's something you're interested in.
Yeah, and if people ever have questions about it, I'm happy to talk about my experience with it.
Awesome. Reach out to Kathleen if you have any questions about the chess. And then before we go into the Furious Five, I would like to ask you, where would you like to see yourself in the future?
No, I have no idea. Stay tuned. Let's see where I end up.
Yeah, I appreciate the honesty in that, and I feel like that is absolutely fine. like just looking at that, the general path that you've taken, it's not like, okay, you need to have everything in line and understood. I feel like just building out the skill sets and the knowledge of the things that you do, and as you see fit, you'll be able to transition from one role to the next, and like getting the certifications and all the things, it's just like build up your resume and your professional background to really get and position yourself to be a strong candidate for many types of positions. So yeah, we look forward to that. Be sure to follow Kathleen on LinkedIn so we can see where the journey goes from here. And then going into the Furious Five, the last section of the show. Number one, what advice would you give to a student trying to pursue a career in public health?
I would say get involved. Start shadowing people. If there are people who are doing what you're interested in or what you think you might be interested in, reach out to them. As somebody who has had students shadow me when I was kind of losing my way, it's also a huge benefit to the people who are working to get to kind of show what they do and why they do it. And it's reinvigorating. So, I think there's a lot of hesitation from students to reach out to people who are like in the work world because they don't want to be a burden to them. But I think there's so much benefit both ways to doing informational interviews and doing shadowing. So that would probably be my biggest advice.
Yeah, the best time to reach out to people is when you're a student. Everyone loves speaking to students. So
yeah.
Number two, if you're talking to someone wanting to get into your position, what advice would you give them?
Have a thick skin, know yourself, and be willing to stand firm in the decisions you're making, because you're going to be making very controversial decisions where every step you take, you are doing absolutely the right thing to some people and absolutely the wrong thing to others. So just, you know, knowing yourself and trusting yourself to make those really hard calls.
Appreciate the candid answer. What's something, number three, what's something you are working on improving in your life right now?
Balance. So I kind of have been all over the place recently, and just kind of refining that balance. So today is October 31st while we're recording this, and I made a promise to myself that I'm going to do November sober. So that's something that I'm working on too, is not drinking alcohol in November. So stay tuned for that too.
Yeah, love that for you. I believe this episode is coming out in December. So reach out to Kathleen, see if she's successful in no drinking November. Number four. Professionally, do you recommend anything?
So I think some of the things that have helped me the most professionally are healing the personal parts as well and learning who I am and then bringing me into what I do. So I cannot recommend Brené Brown and her work enough. There are some air squats or burpees for you. but yeah, seriously, like doing the personal work will only help you professionally as well.
Yeah. How about the jersey t-shirt you're wearing? I feel like there's a pretty cool organization that people might want to connect
Thank
to
you.
As well.
Thanks for reminding me. So yes, I'm representing Sisters of Public Health. They are an awesome organization of women in public health. There's a chapter in Philly that I am moderately involved in. I would like to be involved more again as I have more time. But yeah, they're awesome. Angela, the founder, is amazing and is doing great work connecting women within the public health world.
Absolutely. And I when this is released, I would have had it on. So if you want to find out more about Citizen Public, I'll definitely just go back and check out that episode with Angela. But yeah, definitely a great organization doing great work. Number five, where can people connect with you?
Instagram's probably best. So my Instagram is LV Ladybird, as in Lehigh Valley Ladybird. Find me on Instagram. I do have LinkedIn, but admittedly, I'm not very active on it. So if you reach out on LinkedIn and I don't respond, reach out to me on Instagram. I'm much better with that.
Awesome. And I'll be sure to put the Instagram link as well as the LinkedIn link there. That makes sense. But appreciate you sharing. Thank you so much, Kathleen, for coming on and sharing your journey, sharing your story, sharing your insight, sharing your candid struggles and getting over that and super bloom. Yeah. Look forward to seeing where the journey continues to take you.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Omari. It's been a really good time talking with you.
Awesome. It's really, really my pleasure. Housekeeping items, everyone. Thank you all so much for watching this or listening to this. Be sure to subscribe if you've gotten this far. Greatly appreciate that. Leave a like if you're watching this on YouTube. 5-star review if you're listening to any podcast platform, and share it with a friend. Greatly helps the show get out to more people and helps them navigate their public health journey. Peace, everyone.